can I welcome you all to tonight's meeting of the pension committee. A little bit of change in our committee makeup. First of all, I'd like to welcome Cathy Watson to our pensions committee. I'm sure hopefully you'll enjoy being on the pensions committee. It is, I think, a worthwhile committee to be involved in. And certainly, we're all friendly and supportive in this committee. Having said that, it's nice to see Paul back from hospital and on his road to recovery. It's also tonight the last meeting of Harry, the Pensions Committee. So we've still got the investment monitor working on, but this is the last Pensions Committee that Harry will be at, so we'll certainly miss his input. And Mike Hornby as well, as is no longer with us on this committee. And again, he'll be sadly missed. Peter and I were just talking and reflecting. He's been a valuable member of this pensions committee, so both Harry and Mike will be missed. So, having said all that, if I can just see if there's any apologies. I do have two apologies. First of all, Councillor Crofts from Liverpool has given us apologies. And also, Councillor John Fulham from St Helens.
Councillor Emily Bathroom?
We knew that she wasn't at the briefing, did we? So that's good. We've got that apology recorded as well. Okay. Right. It then remains for me to ask for declarations of interest. If we've got any declarations of interest that need to be noted.
Can I declare the interest chair and a member of the pension fund?
And myself, as usual, and my wife being a member of the pension fund.
And my father-in-law, a member of the pension fund.
Oh, I don't know whether it's worth mentioning that George usually makes a declaration.
He does not. He is here. His wife will be in. Normally declares for his wife.
He will be in.
Thank you. That's been noted then. Okay, thank you. So, thank you for that participation. So, tonight, items 3 and 4, before we get to that, the minutes of our last meeting, for those who've had the opportunity to look at the minutes, I'll take a moment on there to look at those. And then when you have the opportunity to do that, if anyone wants to propose it as a correct record and seconded by somebody as well, please.
Yeah.
Okay. Proposed and seconded, so all happy to agree them as a
correct
record.
Agreed.
Okay. I'll just sign that then. We have items 3 and 4, which are going to be presented to us this evening by Grant Thornton. We've got a reference to our audit plan and a presentation about stronger future development of local government pension schemes. So, are you happy to present those two items together to us?
Yes, thank you.
Can
I cover the audit plan and then I'll come to the floor to
Thank you. So just by way of introduction, my name is Heather Green, I'm from Grant Thornton, your external auditors. I'm just going to run through the audit plan, which starts on page 9 of your papers. This is the audit plan. We present this to you each year. It sets out the key sort of risks and issues that we've identified that we consider to be relevant to the audit we will undertake on the accounts of the pension fund for 2014-15. I won't go through it necessarily page by page, but I'll just highlight some of the key points and happy to take any questions either to go along or at the end of the item. So firstly, just on pages 4 and 5 of the audit plan, there are sort of two pages heading up, understanding your business and developments relevant to your business and the audit. These two pages set out those matters that we've identified as being sort of the key issues, challenges, opportunities, national developments that are relevant to the pension fund. And the second half of those pages, under the heading Our Response, just summarises how we will consider those issues, what we will do, how we'll take that into account as part of the work we undertake with the pension fund. Page 6 is just a diagram which aims to sort of summarise the audit approach and the various things that we take into account as part of the audit. On page 7 of the report, headed up significant risks. Significant risk is a term that is defined by the International Standards on Auditing. The the definition set out there at the top of the page. The auditing standards assume two significant risks for all audits, for all entities. So the first two items in that table, the significant risks identified as revenue cycle, including fraudulent transactions and management override of controls. They are what we would term to be default significant risks, so you would expect to see those in the audit plan of any organisation if they are things that are specific or to Merseyside Pension Fund. So the table there just sets out the work that we would propose to do. The first one around the assumed risk that there would be fraudulent transactions within revenue streams. We've actually, based on our understanding of the way the fund operates and the work that we've done in the past, we've concluded that actually that risk isn't a significant risk for the pension fund due to the nature of the revenue streams for the pension fund. The final item on that page under significant risk just relates to what we've termed there as the level three investments or the alternative investments, hard to value investments. Significant risks can often relate to things that require a lot of judgment, so we've identified these as being a significant risk on the basis that the valuation of those investments does involve a significant degree of judgment, and therefore we need to undertake appropriate audit procedures to address the risks due to the nature of the valuations and the degree of judgment involved in valuing those investments. Over the page then, pages 9 to 10, we'll turn the other risks. These again, what we have for each different type of organisation that we audit, there are common risks that we would expect to see depending on the nature of the organisation. So for pension funds, these are common risks, and it's more very likely that if you were to pick up an audit plan for a pension fund elsewhere, you would see very, very similar items there under the other risks. And it just reflects the nature of the transaction streams that go through the pension fund. Page 11 summarises the work that is currently in progress this time of year. We refer to it as the interim work, the work that we do before the financial statements have been prepared. Summary on that page of the work that we're doing, conclusions to date, as I say, some of that work is still in progress, but there's nothing that we need to bring to the attention of this committee based on the work that you've undertaken so far. Just some key dates on page 13 in terms of timing of the work. And then page 14 just sets out the scale fee, which has been set previously by the Audit Commission, and a small fee variation which relates to the assurances that we provide to admitted body auditors in respect to the IAS 19. And I'm looking at Donna, but I think ordinarily you recharge that to the admitted bodies that actually have been cost to the pension. That was all I was going to say on that, so I'm happy to take any questions or comments that members have, and anything that's in there.
Thanks. Have we got any questions? I know those individuals who are also at the Audit and Risk Management have already reviewed this document, but for those who weren't or would like to ask any questions, no, so we're happy to note the contents of that report and thank the Brandon Thornton for the work that they've done in providing that information for us. Thank you. So over to item 4 then.
Yes, item 4 was just to bring to the attention of the members of the Pension Committee our latest report on governance and pension funds across the LGPS. Members may recall that about 18 months or so ago we did a national report, and this is a follow-up on that report, but it's very much in the context of the new requirements around governance arrangements, local pension boards. So what we're trying to do is pull out in that report sort of key features of governance arrangements and things that local pension boards may wish to give some priority to or focus to as they get going. So it's very much designed to be a tool to help the local pension boards, but also in terms of pension committees, if they want to consider their current arrangements in the light of creating a local pension board. So it's just there for information. I have brought some copies with me if anyone wants to take away a copy.
Yeah, I'd like to take one.
In that case, I will retrieve some more from my boots.
Right, so we'll have to take that away and read it and understand. There's, for those who have had the opportunity to look at it, has anyone seen it in advance? I'm not sure. No. No. Officers have. Peter, are you happy with the information to provide?
Yes, it's helpful because, as Fiona says, it looks at the practice across local authority pension funds around the country and identifies areas of good practice. We're pleased to mention that Merseyside does feature in the report as one in one area, but it's a good check for us to think about what we're doing and why we're doing it, and things that we may not have thought about or things that we can do differently. Last time we brought it to our governance and risk working party, so our proposal would be to do that again at the governance and risk working party in July, and we can perhaps spend a bit more time just going through this and speaking about areas of particular interest all for discussion.
Yeah, that's a good suggestion. I think we should follow that then. So, okay, so you don't have to rush right away.
No.
You're leaving anyway.
The meeting,
okay. Right, so we take our copies away, and then, as Peter's quite rightly suggested, we can discuss the documents at the Governance and Risk Working Party. Thank you. So, thank you for that presentation this evening. Okay, so on to agenda item 5, and this is with reference to local government pension scheme update, and Yvonne, as usual, will give us tonight's presentation.
Thank you, Chair. This report updates members on the 2014-15 pension scheme bill, which recently became an act, and legislates for the freedom of trade and pension flexibilities announced in the 2014 budget. Also covers the shadow scheme of badly called project, the management of deficits, and the council's opinion received on the statutory basis of federal promise. Section 2.1 to 2.6 refers to the Act and the measures which allow people over age 55 to access their personal pensions in more flexible ways from April, including the ability to access the total pension pot as cash. Like the unfunded scheme, the government has continued to allow transfers out of the LGPS to defined contribution schemes, as they don't cause a cash burden for the state. Although the government has raised concerns that members transferring from defined benefit schemes like the LGPS would not understand the long-term impact of their decisions. Also, if there is a large increase in members transferring, this could have an impact on cash flow and liquidity that may cause the fund to sell the wrong type of assets at the wrong time. As a result, there are safeguards within the Act that require members to obtain advice from an authorised independent financial advisor at their own cost before transferring to a DC scheme. In addition, draft regulations have been issued to allow DCLG to reduce transfer values. However, the Secretary of State must be convinced that the number and value of transfers will require the fund to sell assets to meet the payments. So it is important to note that any impact will be considered at the total fund level and not at an individual employer level. Section 2.7 to 2.9, along with the appendix, provides a position statement of the scheme of bargaining for the Management Plan 2015. Promotes the use of standard assumptions to calculate funding levels, so deficits are measured consistently across the scheme, and aims to develop metrics around deficit funding plans, investments and governance risks. The remaining section deals with the QC opinion sold by the board on the statutory obligation for administrative authorities to guarantee pension benefits. The key finding is that the accepted view that LGPS benefits are guaranteed by the admin authority and backed by central government is not explicitly provided for in the regulations. Although the QC found that in principle his finances are exhausted. In the interest of the scheme's sustainability, the scheme advisory board has been tasked with seeking amendment to the regulations to clarify that the admin authority must provide a statutory guarantee to underpin the payments of current and future benefits. Section 3 covers the main risk that increased transfers could have an adverse impact on cash flow, with the need to review the treasury management policy and liquidity position. Conversely, Section 8 notes that an increase in transfers could reduce liabilities and the fund's exposure to longevity improvements. The recommendation is that members may be resolved. I'm happy to take any questions, Chair.
Harry?
Yeah, Yvonne, you didn't mention this, the need to, or the maybe a need to free up some less liquid assets. Could you just detail what that involves, please? What that may involve?
To free up less liquid assets.
Second paragraph of 3.1.
I think what I'm talking about there, Harry, is if we have a rush of members electing or opting to transfer out, our policy at the moment is largely invested in assets that aren't easily accessible, and if it came to the point where our liquidity position was under threat, that there could be we would need to sell assets at a time where it's not a market at an inflated rate, depressed rate, and it could
The pension funds wouldn't really be getting value for money if they had to, because there will be a splurge of a need to free up these assets of one kind or another. So the pension funds may well lose out on what they would normally get on those those returns. Yeah.
Yes, that's quite right. If we had to sell illiquid assets, often you have to accept a discount to the price.
Spits emporium, it is.
So what Harry's saying then is that if there's a rush on the banks, we'll have to sell the value silver to cover the costs.
Spits emporium.
Has anyone got any other questions?
There are other people waiting to speak here.
question with it. I mean, I personally think there might be a Russian cars, you know, also we see lots of new cars, but I take your point, Kathy, I understand that. Chris, you had a comment?
Yeah, I was just going to ask, do we have any information about how big an event this is going to be for those pension companies?
In the last 6 months, we have had an increase of requests for cash equivalent quotes of an around 41% increase of requests for information. Nobody's actually taking them out at this point in time, but they've requested the information.
There's an increase of 41%. That sounds huge, but if it's a small portion before, 41% is a small portion, it's not a great deal. So
yeah, the figures around about
140,
and we've had 165.
Right, so it's not the same. So you wouldn't say it was a significant amount so far.
Any more comments, sir? As we heard, there's not a rush on the bank. We certainly don't want to be. We want our members to stay in the fund and continue to benefit from the excellent benefits that they enjoy as part of a government and pension scheme. So.
I just said that through some experience as well, that in Australia they have the same type of drawdown, and most people don't actually take the pension pot as cash. They'll rather have drawdown on an income, but that's in Australia.
Interestingly, actually, I was at a meeting this morning where that very point was discussed, actually, and there was a representative who was Australian who made the very same point that Yvonne's just made. So we hope that's the case, and we continue to keep our funds intact. Okay, is there any more questions? Okay, I know it's quite complex, and there are a few unknown issues related to that, but thank you for that, and there was a recommendation that we note the report as it stands.
Great.
Okay, thank you. Right. Okay, agenda item 6 is to do with the pension board, and before I start with this, actually, again, I did refer to the fact that it was at a LAPF meeting, local authority pension forum, this today, down in London, where there was a number of other pension funds there, and there was a considerable amount of discussion on this very item again. And I'd just like to congratulate our own officers actually on the work that they've put into getting us ready for this the pension board. A number of other authorities have struggled with this and don't have boards in place, and I think our officers have done well to get us where we are now. So having said that, I'll hand over to Peter.
Yes. Thank you, Chair. Members will recall that we brought a report to the last committee where we had draft terms of reference, because we're still waiting for the final regulations, the final governance regulations, and the final guidance. Post-pensions committee, those regulations were laid and final guidance was issued. We had to take a recommendation to council on the 16th of March, so that was agreed with the Chair of Pensions Committee. And the authority monitoring officer, and council did approve the final terms of reference, which are attached as Appendix 1 to this report. Under Section 2, we set out some of the changes that there were between the draft regulations and the final regulations. Under Section 2.2, the changes were firstly that voting rights only apply to members of the board who either employer or member representatives, anyone that's independent, such as the chair, doesn't have a vote. Secondly, elected members of administering authorities can only sit on the local board as either an employer or a member representative, and not as another member of the board. It was also clarified that obviously the elected members involved in the discharge of the LGPS are eligible for appointment to other pension boards, just not to their local pension board. The requirement for employer and member representatives to have appropriate experience has been dropped, but nonetheless, there's still the requirement for members to acquire appropriate knowledge and understanding of pensions matters, and also that another qualifying criteria is that they need to have the capacity to represent employees and members, which principally revolves around having the time to devote both to attendance of meetings and attendance at the end of the training. There's a statutory requirement under the Pensions Act for members of boards to have knowledge and skills. And finally, just comment that although there is provision for the establishment of joint local pension boards, the criteria draws tightly, and there's likely to be very limited opportunity for funds to be able to set up a joint board. And then finally, under section 2.3, there's a clarification that the regulations confirmed that the notional employer cost cap has been set at 14.6% of pay by the Treasury. Under section 2.5, there are links there to the guidance. And under section 2.6, a link to the Pension Regulator's Code of Practice, which the fund will become subject to from the 1st of April. And under section 2.7, there is an online e-learning programme which I would recommend for those who would like to be more familiar with the 7 modules. Yvonne's had a look at those and she tells me that they're reasonably accessible, and it's important that members have some familiarity with the pension regulator requirements, which will also apply to pension boards. Under section 2.8, we just comment about the timetable. We appreciate the chair's comments that we managed to get the term of reference in place for the 1st of April, but we still need to appoint members to the pension board. So although we've got approval of council on the 16th of March, we do need to appoint a selection panel and then appoint members to the board and have a meeting of the board by no later than the end of July this year. Under risks, we point out that the intention of the board is to mitigate risks and to assist both the fund and the administering authority with the discharge of the LGPS. And finally, members are asked to note the final regulations and that there was approval at council on the 16th of March of the final terms of reference. Thank you, Chair.
Start off just a couple of questions. I understand that we do have people who've expressed an interest in being on the board, and perhaps can I ask for a comment as to what is the next step then? What do we now need to do to get people onto the board?
Well, members of the selection board, which is appointed, possibly under delegated powers, in consultation with the party leaders. I would think that's the next step to take.
Thank you, Roger.
So that's been facilitated, yeah. Okay. Sorry, any questions of Peter with regards to this report?
Just for the record, there should be two corrections to the draft terms of reference, or also the final terms of reference under Appendix 1. Firstly, under section 4.12, it should refer to section 10 rather than section 8 of the document. And then under section 17.2, it's the rate prescribed by the inland revenue rather than prescribed. So we'll reflect those changes, Chair, in the final version that's published. And clearly, although it was approved by Council on the 16th, it will take effect from the 1st of April when the regulations come into force.
Okay, thank you, Peter. So I will thank the officers again for the work they've put into this, because it's in addition to the responsibilities that the executive board to put this together for us. So I'm grateful for that and look forward to a further report and as the progress of getting the board in place and to the first meeting.
Committee.
Which takes us to agenda item 7, which is a map of local authority conference, and again, over to Peter for this presentation.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The NAPF local authority conference takes place between the 18th and 20th of May down in Gloucester. The conference is themed building a strong and sustainable LGPS. Previously, the fund has been represented by the chair of the committee and spokespersons. But clearly, the recommendation is that the committee considers if it wishes to send a delegation, and if so, the number and allocation of places. I understand there is a clash with the committee agenda or the council's agenda.
There is, and there is a George.
Obviously, we've discussed it before, and we are in a good clash with the second part of the full council. As I was suggesting before, I was having Nancy here now as well. I just don't believe that there is a problem as long as, because none of us know the way that the council after maybe 7 until that date comes through. And that would be right in the picture of it all. So, do we think that what normally sensibly happens for anything like this is if the chair is yourself and Jeff or Chris, then 1-1-1 going together doesn't make a difference. So, I would stipulate that should be the case. If it was anything different to that, it was that close, then you'd probably get to be that good by people next. But I think in under the present circumstances, I would say it'd be 1-1-1. It's okay.
Yeah, I think if we can ask the officers to make the arrangements, we're grateful for that. And when we know a definite time frame, dates, you'll be able to actually So happy to note the contents of the report and the chair and the party spokespersons attend the conference. Agenda item 8, which again is the local government pension committee and the TRUSTEES conference of language. Again, Peter's
going. Yes, this committee is down in Cardiff on the 25th and 26th of June. Previously, it's been open to all members of the pensions committee. It's a good balance both investment and administration, so the content is normally useful for all members of our committee. It's snappily entitled Know Your Onions, and it's for committee to consider attendance and approve delegation if appropriate.
Okay, so just to comment for a moment, there is a responsibility of the members of the pension committee to invest time and energies in taking up training opportunities as presented to us. So I think as chair, I'd like to encourage those members who are able to attend to attend and take up this training opportunity as we can. Is there a deadline, or will Emma contact us? So for those members not familiar, Emma from the Merseyside Pension Fund will contact us individually and ask us to confirm whether we're able to attend on the dates as proposed. So otherwise, are there any questions regarding that event? No? Okay, so thank you for that report and your comments, Peter. Okay, so over to agenda item 9. And there is actually an exempt item on this. So first of all, though, I think Yvonne, you can present to us, and then we'll go to the exempt item later on. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you
for the
present
for
the
fundraising officer on £10,069 in the stress of over.
deemed irrevocable. OVERPAYMENTS arise when the fund does not receive timely information when a member dies or when a child pension remains in payment when they have ceased full-time education. The exempt schedule provides details of the four cases that have exceeded the £1,000 limit which the Section 151 officer has a policy to raise off.
Sorry, Ron, you caught me chatting.
No.
Okay. Are there any questions that you'd like to ask of Yvonne? To me, it seems quite straightforward. Obviously, as I say, there is an exempt item in relation to this, but do we have any questions for Yvonne?
Yvonne, could I just ask, how much pensions do you pay out a year?
Current payroll is £17 million a month, which will take that to £204 million a year.
It's a good question, isn't it? It's a concept, I suppose. Thank you.
It's got a,
happy to move that